Good morning, everyone. My name is Claire Pengelly, and I head up the Water and Agriculture team at GreenCape. Welcome to this event. We're going to be talking all about unlocking business opportunities for small, medium, and micro-sized enterprises in the South African municipal water sector. Before we officially kick off with the event, and while we wait for people to arrive, I'm going to queue up a video that should come through in just a moment, just briefly outlining the opportunities for the municipal water sector. Tula, over to you, if you can hit up the video. Thank you. The water and sanitation market within South Africa, more broadly in the Western Cape, is largely characterized by long-term investment drivers, such as water scarcity, largely driven by climatic change and recurrent droughts, ensuring sufficient water for sustainable economic growth and development, and equitable access to water and sanitation to all its citizens.
Your National Department of Water and Sanitation is the one that has put this ahead of us to say, if we are to meet the SDGs in 2030, which is universal access to water and sanitation, we need to focus on reducing our losses. And we need to also focus on other opportunities that will ensure that we become a country that is water resilient even beyond 2030. One key driver, of course, is legislation or governance that always puts us at the point of, looking deep into investing in water. And one of those is this imminent organic waste landfill ban in 2027. Although it's looking into the Western Cape, but what I can say is that we need to ensure that there is a circular economy as part of the SDGs, SDG 12. So we also look into ensuring that we convert our waste from the landfills. Looking into 2030, we are looking at a 10% gap between demand and supply when talking about water. So that's that particular gap that we would like to ensure that we cover it by augmenting and bringing in more water supply schemes than the ones that we've been having, because we've been solely dependent on surface water.
So we identified three key municipal sector opportunities. Firstly, non-revenue water reduction, and secondly, non-sewered sanitation systems, and thirdly, alternative disposal or beneficiation of wastewater sludge. The non-revenue water reduction is key for our water scarce country to reduce the impact of our water uses on community and the businesses. Business continuity is critical, and water supply can really enhance their businesses. It's also important for municipal revenue recovery, which can aid operation and maintenance in the water sector and thereby offsetting capital expenditure on future expansions. Looking at our second opportunity, non-sewered sanitation systems, which are critical for access to sanitation, achieving the sustainability development goal of clean water and sanitation access. These systems can be an alternative for conventional sanitation systems, especially in informal settlements, new communities, and low-income housing. And our third opportunity, alternative disposal or beneficiation of wastewater sludge, is critical as liquids have been banned from disposal at landfill. And in future, the country is aiming to reduce the solid waste organics to landfill by 2030.
Thank you very much. So thank you, everyone. I think we're ready to officially kick off the event. And we've got a jam-packed agenda ahead of us. So first, we're going to hear some welcoming remarks from Minister Mania, and we'll hand over to him in just a second. After that, we will hear from one of the authors of the Water Market Intelligence Reports, Ashton Mpofu, who you saw in our video just a moment ago. He's going to be spending a bit more time digging into the details of the investment and business opportunities in the municipal water sector. Then we'll have a bit of Q&A after that. So if you have any particular questions you would like to ask, please wait for that and pose them in the Q&A box or the Q&A area within the Zoom webinar. Then we will hand over to Rudy Buerta, who you also just saw on that the video just a moment ago. She's going to be speaking a little bit about, you know, as a business, particularly an SMME, what are the best entry points for entering the South African public water sector market? Again, once she's done her presentation, we'll again open up for Q&A. And then finally, we'll be handing over to Adila Kasim, who's from the Green Outcomes Fund, and she'll be talking about some of the opportunities that exist for finance for green SMMEs, particularly through the fund that she supports. So we're going to hand over now to Minister Mania. I think just to make a note that we're also going to launch a poll at the same time. So you'll see it pop up in your window. And we're really just interested to find out who's here in the room. So you will see it's basically just asking you, what role does your business currently play within the water sector? So we're really just trying to get a sense of the composition of the attendees within this particular event. I think maybe just before we move over to the video, as mentioned, I would really encourage everyone to introduce themselves in the chat. If you're able to, you know, put in your name and your company, possibly a little bit about, you know, what your company does, be really interesting to see. And obviously thinking about this from a collaborative and networking perspective. Also, just to say that this event has been made possible through the funding from the provincial, the Western Cape Department of Economic Development and Tourism. We're very fortunate to have been partnering with them since 2010, and they also fund the market, water market intelligence report, as well as the brief that Rudy will be talking about around actually entering the water sector market. So yeah, just a big thanks to them as well for making all of this possible. So if Tula, if you don't mind teeing up the video from Minister Mania. David Mania is the Western Cape Provincial Minister of Finance and Economic Opportunities. He was unable to make it today, but we did get this welcome message from him. Thank you.
Hi, my name is David Mania, and I'm the Minister of Finance and Economic Opportunities in the Western Cape. It gives me great pleasure to welcome you all to this webinar, which will unpack the many long-term investment opportunities for small businesses in the municipal water sector in the Western Cape. Small businesses play a critical role in job creation and economic growth in the Western Cape. This webinar is one of the many ways that we, together with Green Cape, are supporting small businesses to access opportunities in the green economy, particularly in the municipal water sector. I encourage you all to read the market intelligence reports, which are world-class documents produced every year to highlight the many great opportunities for investment in the green economy in the Western Cape. And please do engage with the Green Cape team on the webinar today to find out more about these opportunities. The demand for a green, more resilient future has never been greater. And I'm excited about the role played by small businesses in that future. I thank you.
Fantastic. Thank you very much. So I'm hoping that everyone has submitted their results on the poll. Tula, if you're able to end the poll so we can see those results, assuming we've got some decent data. Ah, there we go. Okay, so fantastic. So we can see we've got a really good composition of consultants and technology suppliers. In fact, technology suppliers are the majority in this particular audience. We've got some service providers and contractors, and then a single government representative. So really interesting to see we've got a really good mix here across the kind of roles and responsibilities within the water sector that we can speak to various different opportunities. Okay, thank you very much. I think, again, just to encourage everyone to please introduce yourself in the chat so we all know what we're doing here. I'm seeing these coming through at the moment. Really, really interesting to see who's attending. I'm going to now hand over to Ashton. Ashton Mpofu is a senior water analyst at Green Cape. He was the key or the primary author of this, the 2021 Water Market Intelligence Report. And he's going to be speaking to you today around investment and business opportunities in the municipal water sector market. Just a reminder, at the end of this, we're going to go over to some Q&A. So as you go through it and you've got some questions, please pop those questions into the Q&A and we'll address them towards the end. Thank you.
Thanks, Claire, for the kind introductions. One of those, if you're hosting on Zoom, it seems you have a lot of panels in front of you, so you tend to take time to click one after another. Thank you very much to you all for joining us. And just introduce me, I'm Ashton Mpofu. I was one of the authors for the 2020 and 2021 market intelligence reports. My duty this morning is very simple. It's just to unpack or summarize the two reports, which is one from 2020 and the one from 2021, just to highlight some of those opportunities that are relevant within the public water sector market.
Ashton, sorry to interrupt. You're getting a little bit of, it sounds like your mic is rubbing up against something. If you don't mind just checking, it's creating a bit of disturbance. Thanks. Okay. Sorry to interrupt.
No worries. Okay, so so today I'll be speaking on non-revenue water and energy efficiency at wastewater or water treatment plants. I'll also touch about the water reuse, that is direct potable use at municipalities, also non-soil sanitation systems. Some of you might refer to that as package plants, some of you might refer to that as decentralized sewage treatment. And lastly, I'll touch on the wastewater sludge beneficiation. So firstly, we did highlight non-revenue water, which is looking into water efficiency. We know that when you look into our water sector in South Africa, we have a problem, or we are plagued with what you call edge infrastructure. So we seem to be losing lots of water from our reticulation systems. So we looked at this opportunity to say that what if we have interventions to ensure that we plug the leaks, as they will say, and also increase our supply. So we highlighted that according to DWS, there is about a total investment of 676 million over the next 10 years, when it comes to plugging the leaks. So we're looking into technologies such as smart metering or smart cities and so forth. So looking into the provinces, across the country, we have got a total investment of about 676. This has been given off by DWS itself. And looking at the total savings, for plugging leaks, we're talking about 7.4 billion rands per year. But this figure has just risen due to the increase in tariffs, over the last months. And now we're talking about almost 9.9 billion rands per year. So this is a low hanging fruit that if we could across the country, venture into non-revenue water projects and ensure that our municipalities do not use as much water as they are at the moment. So on average, as a country, we are sitting at around about 37%. And across some of the provinces, it's actually very dire. Looking at some provinces losing up to about 50% in terms of non-revenue water. So there's a lot that can be done, in terms of plugging the leaks and ensuring that we don't lose as much water. I must also highlight that, some of this not only on physical losses, there's also theft. Some people do steal our water, and there are issues with faulty buildings as well. We've heard about people being built over millions of rands, in a residential place. So we need to get in and use, technologies to ensure that we've got adequate billing, accurate billing, and we don't lose as much water. So looking into the drivers and barriers, I think the most important for today is to look into the barriers that, there is a lack of technical capacity within the municipal sector for this particular opportunity. And there's also complex contracting financing models. So my colleague Rudy is going to touch on this later on. There's also lack of locally proven technologies as well. So when you look into the municipalities, they always want to work with something that they they have dealt with before. So they need to trust the technology. So they need to have experiences before. So there's lack of those locally proven, you know, technologies at the moment. And also there is financial insolvency of some of these municipalities. So it's very difficult, you know, for financiers to come into the space and offer loans and so forth due to the insolvency of some of our municipalities. I wouldn't go deep into that. You know about the auditor's report that just came out a few months ago, how we spend our monies within some of the municipalities. Going ahead now, sorry, I seem to be starting to use button here. We also looked into energy efficiency within the water and waste treatment works. So this was looking into, you know, incorporating energy efficient technologies within our treatment works. So we're talking about efficient pump, efficient, you know, incorporating efficient retrofits, even using variable speed drives within treatment works. So there's a total investment of about 1 billion across the metros, with the city of Cape Town, of course, having, you know, potential cost savings in energy of about 65 million rands per year. So this is also a huge savings if we were to go across all the treatment works, you know, in our metros and, you know, incorporate or upgrade, you know, our technologies that are used there and ensure that we incorporate very efficient technologies. So looking into the barriers as well, there is also a lack of technical capacity. We have spoken to municipalities and they've heard, you know, about even the struggles when it comes to maintaining some of these technologies because they've been imported from overseas. So when, you know, they break down, it's always difficult to get a local supplier, local, you know, business to come and do the ops and maintenance. So there's a need, you know, for you know, technical capacity within municipalities to ensure that they're able to do the maintenance on some of these technologies. Also looking at financing as well, as this title in terms of non-revenue, same applies here. And then there's also a poor business case for some projects as well. You know, you buy very expensive equipment and then your energy savings, of course, they'll take a very long time. So the payback period is a bit longer. So there is a need for, you know, good, you know, business cases for such technologies. And then there's also operational complexity as well. You know, some of these technologies, like, you know, linking to like of technical capacity, it's very difficult, you know, to operate them. You know, so we need to upskill our process controllers within the treatment works so that they'll be able, you know, to man some of these technologies. Moving on and looking into wastewater slash beneficiation, this part I will touch on the provincial side of things. We see that Gauteng does dispose a lot of its sludge, which produces about 819 tons, you know, of sludge annually. And the Western Cape at about 264. So we, as the Western Cape, we contribute about 14% of the waste treated sludge that we produce. So we're looking into the sludge that comes from the treatment works, so whether it's primary or secondary. So there is a potential, you know, to find alternatives of disposing that sludge. One of the biggest drivers, of course, we have got a waste strategy as a country that want to reduce landfilling of organic waste by, you know, 75% in 2030. And within the Western Cape, we're looking at reducing this by 50% by next year. So we are just a few months in realizing that goal. And then there will be a total organic waste landfill ban in 2027. So we need to start looking into finding alternatives of disposing our sludge and also, you know, tapping into circular economy if this sludge can be beneficiated into, you know, valuable products that can be used, you know, across our value chain. Of course, looking into, you know, the metros again, it's always good to look into the metros because this is where, you know, the largest of the business is. Of course, Johannesburg goes ahead since it has got the largest population and also the largest number of the treatment works. We're talking about, you know, spending in total across metros about 340 million that is spent in terms of transporting and disposing our sludge. So some of it goes to landfill and some of it goes to land application that is more sacrificial land, you know, land that is not used to grow any food crops. But there are possibilities, you know, of beneficiating this land into a fertilizer that can be used for proper land application and for growing food crops as well. So, you know, any technologies or any services that can be done in terms of beneficiating our sludge and converting to valuable products, there is a big opportunity in that regard. Of course, if one has to look into, you know, the barriers as well, there's policies and regulations. You need to register fertilizer. So that's more of a regulatory, you know, barrier. You know, there's also lack of capital investment. You know that in the municipal space, there's always lack of, you know, grant funding. So if people can come in, you know, through, you know, very innovative financing models or through loans to assist the treatment works or the municipalities, you know, to go into projects like this of beneficiating sludge. And also, you know, your produced products, you know, can also be, you know, difficult to get them into the market because you've got this public perception, you know, that you are giving us something that comes from sewage. So there's a need for one to really, you know, be innovative as well in engaging communities or the public in terms of accepting some of these products that come from, you know, beneficiating sludge. Also, there's a circular economy infrastructure gap, you know, which is also a potential driver. Now, looking, if this is the opportunity highlighted in 2020, looking at, you know, using that sludge as well in producing biogas that will then be converted into electricity. So there is a SIPR report 2016 that did all the analysis of the treatment works across the country, and only a few of them, you know, have got that potential of, you know, being having a good business case in terms of beneficiating sludge, converting it into biogas, which will then be used to produce electricity within the treatment works. So there's a capital investment of almost about, you know, 240 million in terms of the Western Cape. And looking to Gauteng is about 545 million as well. So yeah, that sludge can be used, I mean, to produce electricity within the treatment works, or someone can actually track it out of the treatment works and beneficiate it into something else. But in total, you know, for all these feasible projects, we're looking at about 1.1 billion. So one of the biggest, you know, drivers in terms of this is looking into energy security master plan, where you're looking at diversifying our energy sources. And we know about the big windows now and increase in terms of, you know, independent power production that was released recently. So there is also an opportunity to use the sludge to produce biogas, or that can even be used further to produce electricity. And in terms of biogas projects, there's one of the biggest barriers is lack of technical capacity. You know, it's a very finicky process. You know, if anything goes wrong, then, you know, you can't continue, you need to start afresh. So we need, you know, our process controllers to really be skilled in terms of being able to man or to run this, you know, process. Then looking into water reuse as well, we have got, you know, an investment opportunity, you know, for a total of about 50 billion, and mainly looking into the inland provinces, you know, and coastal provinces. I mean, can also look into, you know, desalination. But in terms of inland provinces, I think there's a big opportunity in terms of, you know, direct potable reuse, converting our wastewater into a drinking water standard. I mean, the city of Cape Town does have a project that is to be coming through, I think, in 2026-24, where we are going to be producing our own 70 to 100 MLD of, you know, direct potable reuse. Looking into the values there, capital investment of about 23 billion in Gauteng, and in the Western Cape, we're looking at about, you know, 8.1 billion to be specific. So the reuse capacity of Western Gauteng is over 1,000 megaliters a day. And in the Western Cape, we're talking about 380 megaliters a day. So yeah, there are opportunities, you know, to just, you know, convert your wastewater into drinking water standard, or even process water for industries. Of course, this looks into the augmentation or looking for alternative sources as we build towards universal access to drinking water by 2030. So one of the biggest barriers, of course, is public perception and health risk. These days we talk about contaminants of emerging concern, and also the operational capacity, operational complexity, and you know, capacity within the treatment works, because you need, you know, people to man these membrane technologies within the municipal sector. So I hope that everyone has been able to, you know, put themselves into some of these opportunities to say, what can your business do in each and one of these opportunities? But I'm happy to have my colleague Rudy to unpack that at a later stage. And finally, we did look into non-source sanitation systems. We know that we still have people, you know, across the country that still do not have access to sanitation. We refer to dignified sanitation. So in this opportunity, we looked at, you know, providing sanitation for the first time, or looking at, you know, providing dignified sanitation. So by definition, according to States SA, we're looking into replacing all unventilated pit latrines, you know, all bucket forms of sanitation or chemical toilets. So we know that through this SA definition is a bit of in terms of looking into some of these technological, you know, sanitation systems as buckets, you know, like portable flush toilets and so forth. So please do not be alarmed. We just clustered into bucket toilets. But looking into the Western Cape, you know, you see that we have about, you know, 140, you know, thousand households that still need, you know, dignified sanitation. And we're talking an investment of almost about 2 billion. So you see that orange bar there representing, you know, bucket toilets is because we've got a huge number of chemical toilets and, you know, these other forms of sanitation that have been defined as bucket toilets. So, you know, and recently there was a media release by the city of Cape Town due to constraint developments, you know, due to lack of, you know, capacity within our treatment works. So there is an opportunity, you know, to install these non-soil sanitation systems, particularly ones that allow you to flush and you reuse that water again to flush over and over again. So you harness, you know, tapping into a circular economy in order to ensure that we've got, you know, access to sanitation, you know, that our tenants can go ahead. Lastly, looking into the province as well, at the city of Cape Town, we're talking about 2 billion rands of capital investment, and Ekuru Lane as well, Johannesburg, which is these are the metros in Gauteng, you know, talking about a total of about 1.5 billion in terms of investment. So one of the biggest barriers, you know, I know that some of our businesses that are in this space are always struggling with policies and bylaws and regulations that make it onerous to install these non-soil sanitation systems. So we really need to step in there and, you know, look into how can we make the, you know, policies or bylaws easier or friendly, you know, and promote this opportunity. You know, there's also, you know, financial insolvency of municipalities. So we need very innovative financing models. And also, you know, looking at public acceptance as well. I know our public, they are still stuck to the gold standard, you know, sanitation of flushing. So if you are providing dry sanitation, there is a big barrier because people don't recognize that there's dignified sanitation. So we need to do a lot as a country to ensure that people do view dry sanitation, you know, as a good way. I think the Water Research Commission is doing a lot in that regard, going to schools and teaching young people about these different forms of sanitation. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. I hope that it was clear, and I'll be happy to take some questions. Back to you, Claire.
Thank you so much, Ashton. It was really good to hear a summary again. And a compilation of all that 2020 work and 2021. It's really, really good to see. So I think just a reminder to everyone, please post some questions into the Q&A. I see George Bennett has posted a question, which I'll post to Ashton in just a moment. But before we do that, I think maybe just a note that we're gonna run another poll. And this is really around looking at, you know, what in terms of the audience that's here, what are the particular opportunities that you're most interested in? So what are the you know, ones that Ashton has highlighted? What are the either as your business or possibly something that you're looking at investing in a later stage? Before I hand back to Ashton and ask him the question, I think maybe just to briefly say we publish these annual reports, these market intelligence reports. They're targeted at investors. So what we try to do is utilize these documents to highlight major market trends, as well as some of the barriers that are emerging or could possibly be hurdles to a possible investment. So they're there, you know, really to try and attract interest within the South African municipal market to really generate some investment activity, but they're certainly not intended to be a comprehensive view of every single piece of technology, et cetera, that could possibly be applied. So I think maybe just a kind of position where these are. Okay, let's hand over to that question that came through. So it seems that George, he's got a question here around the research into resource management in terms of a market mix of commercial and non-commercial usage of water. So it sounds like, I'm not 100% sure, but it sounds like he's looking for, you know, in terms of the actual breakdown of water usage, perhaps locally, but also maybe within South Africa. And maybe you can even just speak to a little bit of the proportions of water that are kind of paid for versus that are offered as free basic allowances. Ashton?
Thanks, Claire, and thanks, George, for the question. I hope I'll be able to answer you or articulate, you know, clearly. I hope you also understood your question. If not, please do feel free to contact us after the webinar. Yeah, looking into our water usage, I think we know that our agriculture, you know, our sector uses, you know, the bulk of our water. They sit at about 62%. So it's varying between 60 and 62. So they're the largest consumer of our water. And also, you know that you always speak about the residentials, you know, that they should do more, but they consume the least of, you know, our water, you know, and industry, of course, or municipalities, you know, they sit, I think, at about 27%, but that's also, you know, a combination of industries that are within a metro or within a municipality that do also, you know, get supplied water by the municipality. So in terms of the, you know, usage mix, I think, you know, we should speak more about, you know, dealing or, you know, working with farmers to ensure that they use less water because they abstract directly from our rivers or directly from, you know, our groundwater sources. It's rarely, you know, do you get farmers using municipal water, unless if you're doing urban farming, of course. My colleague Dr. Kelo can alight more into that. So at the moment, I mean, we mostly looking into, you know, farmers and also your municipalities being the largest consumers, you know, of our water at the moment. I hope that that makes sense. And linking that to opportunities, of course, I think agriculture, we need to reduce their usage. You know, I think they can, you know, they do not need drinking water at all, and they do not need to be maybe abstracting from our rivers. We must find ways of ensuring that agriculture does become, you know, reduce their consumption directly from our sources. And secondly, you know, looking into circular economy as well, can, you know, farmers that are nearer to urban areas, you know, use treated effluent. I mean, the city of Cape Town has got a very, you know, big network, you know, that supplies treated effluent to farmers within, you know, the city of Cape Town, you know, urban village and so forth. So we need to look into that opportunity of farmers using wastewater than them, you know, joining municipalities and abstracting from the rivers. And the pulp and paper industry, of course, that doesn't link to this revenue at the moment, but they're also one of the largest consumers. They abstract directly from the rivers. So if we can work with them and say maybe they should look into using treated effluent because they don't need really drinking water for that purpose.
Thanks, Ashton. I see his second question, I think is probably going to be addressed by Rudy in terms of kind of some of the requirements that are needed to be able to access the market. I see we've also got a question from Joshua that may be partially addressed by Rudy again in the later section, but maybe do you want to unpack what it is that you meant by a lack of locally proven technologies? I can't recall which opportunity that was referring to, but maybe you can kind of spend a bit of time unpacking that a bit more.
Thanks, Joshua, for the question as well. That's a very tricky one because it's relative, you know, so it depends with the municipality. So I would like to say, take it as someone bringing a new product or a phone, you know, even if it's a brand that you are aware about, but if it's a model that you're not used to, then you seem not to be at ease, you know, moving on and using a new version. So if you look into our public sector market as well, you might be a non-brand, but that particular model or that particular product at the time, they've never seen it and they've never used it. So they look into the technical capacity and other things. They don't trust it, you know. That is why maybe some webinars people have spoken about that you are still using a technology that is more than 100 years old, that is an aqueous flush process, you know, with the advancement of technologies and ways of treating water, you know, and, you know, these contaminants making concern and other processes that are technological, we're still stuck with aqueous flush. You know, even if you are creating a treatment works, you will find that you still stick to aqueous flush process. Reason being, it has saved us for centuries. You know, we prefer it and we love it, you know, but there are new technologies, you know, that can do better than actually is large, and that can also embrace circular economy. But we're not willing to step and adopt those. The reason mostly people don't trust them is that skepticism about new technologies in the public sector market. Mm.
And possibly also the difficulties in sometimes piloting those technologies. So even if there's an interest in adopting them, you have to go through the same procurement processes, et cetera, which can be a deterrent to a large extent. I'm not seeing any further questions, but I think maybe just acknowledging Gerard Cronier's comment is the government is only one part of the market. There's huge opportunity in the private sector. And Gerard, you're absolutely correct, right? I mean, there are a number of different markets for the water sector within South Africa. But I think Rudy will talk a bit about why we're specifically talking about the municipal market today. So the municipal market is by far and large kind of the biggest market, or government is the biggest market for the water sector in South Africa. But it's also, so it holds massive opportunity, but it also has particular barriers and hurdles that need to be acknowledged. And so she'll spend a little bit more time digging into that. I think we're heading towards the end then of our Q&A session. I think if you do have any other questions, continue to add them in. Tula, if you can end the poll for us so we can see the final results. See, wow, water reuse comes out as a clear winner. Okay. That's very, very interesting. I guess it's going to be a massive driver, I think, from our perspective, for kind of resource benefit, or like for beneficiation of existing resources, and really thinking about it as a significant augmentation option going into the future for inland as well as coastal communities. But I think still quite a lot of work to be done in terms of kind of the cultural perceptions or the community perceptions of potable reuse. But I guess we're going to watch and see how Cape Town does on this as well in the coming years. Okay, very, very interesting. Thanks. Thank you very much for putting in your interests over there. I'm now going to hand over to Rudy Boerter. Rudy is also a senior water analyst at Green Cape. Towards the end of last year, she published an industry brief around entering the South African public water sector market. And she's going to be taking us through this in a little bit through the presentation now. And this is specifically trying to think through, as a smaller business, so maybe you're not, you know, a massive multinational, what are the kind of pathways that you could consider in terms of entering this public sector market? Okay, thanks, Rudy. Over to you. Thanks so much.
Thanks very much, Claire, and welcome, everybody. My name is Rudy Boerter, and as Claire mentioned, I'll be speaking a little bit about entering the public water sector market. So we will be looking at an introduction to what exactly we're talking about when we're talking about the public water sector market. Some of the roles in a typical infrastructure project, and then briefly summarizing some of the procurement legislation, and then largely focusing on finding partnerships to bid with. So looking at the public water sector, this is an estimate from our industry brief of how much is spent in the 2019-2020 financial year on public water infrastructure. And you can see the divide there from the total of 41 billion in a year. It's largely, it's about two thirds of that is from water boards and water services authorities. And the other third is sort of national entities, multinational entities, the Department of Water Affairs, trading, water trading entity, TCTA, and COBWA. But the majority is really those entities, water boards and WSAs that are providing services to people, water services, wastewater sanitation services. And this is a significant value in the water sector. And that's why we want to discuss it. This is possibly where the largest contributing funding is coming from. And what we perceive as a private sector water market is really originating from this funding. As you will see later on in the presentation, a lot of this public funding ends up in subcontracting agreements that are considered private sector. And so it's important to see where the funding is coming from and to understand what type of projects this fund is interested in. And that can really guide our thinking in the market. So let's take a little bit of a closer look at what all these entities spend their money on in the water sector. We have, I've split them here into bulk water services, water supply services, and then wastewater services, trying to show a little bit of a circular flow there. So when we're talking about bulk services, we're looking at the collection of water, the abstraction of water, the storage, the transfer of raw water. Water supply services, I'm referring to treatment, distribution, sale of potable water. And wastewater services is again the collection of wastewater, the treatment, the discharge, or the reuse of it. And who plays in these sectors? So when we look at bulk water services, we're really talking about those national and multinational entities from the department to COBWA, water boards, and occasionally some of the water services authorities and municipalities that actually supply services. Occasionally they procure their own bulk water services, but on a larger scale, it's really the national entities that procure those types of infrastructure projects. And when we look at water supply services, where people are, where entities are providing the potable water, that falls more on water services authorities. Some water boards take this responsibility as well if they are given it by the department. There's also water service providers. So those are entities that have been hired by water services authorities to provide the service. So it's almost like a subcontracting of the service. There's also water services intermediaries. And these are people that don't, their primary function are not to provide water services, but it may fall on them inadvertently. For example, mines and farms have workers that live on the premises and they are responsible for providing water to those residents. There are many more examples. And on the wastewater services side, similarly, this also falls on WSAs, water boards occasionally if they are designated to do so, and then WSPs and WSIs. And a little example of what these types of projects are, as they are good to look out for in the tenders that come out. On bulk water services, we're looking at dams projects. We're looking at borehole construction or development, bulk pipelines, bulk pump stations, canals, metering, and associated services. On the water supply services, we're looking at water treatment, distribution, so pumps and pipelines, but more on a smaller network level, metering again on a smaller network level and associated services. And then on the wastewater side, again, treatment, collection, and potentially discharge or reuse. So having this bigger picture of what the public water sector looks like and who is tendering and developing water projects helps us to identify which projects your business solution may fit into. If you're in more of the bulk water services arena, you're going to look for projects that are being developed by a different entity than if you're in a more sort of network collection or treatment arena, and that there you would look for projects being developed by water services authorities or water boards rather than the national entities. So aligning what you do with what is available out there is quite important. So now I've displayed here a typical infrastructure life cycle. This is very conceptual and high level, and there are many forms of project life cycles. But just like to discuss this briefly, from origination and conceptualization of a project through design and development, construction and installation, and then into operation and maintenance. If we look at the roles in this project life cycle, and here I've depicted roles in a project life cycle that is typical to the municipal space. We could discuss contracting types like public-private partnerships, which are becoming more and more interesting and developing. But if we look at what actually happens in the public sector right now and in the near future, it's really a design, bid, build type of contract. We'd like to think that public-private partnerships and other types of contracting forms where full solution types might be procured more in future. But currently there seems to be a trend towards these types of structures where a consultant is appointed directly by a public entity. They develop the project and then a contractor is appointed directly by a public entity to construct and install the project. So a very sort of typical infrastructure project in the public sector. So the formal appointments that we have in this life cycle of the project is a consultant being appointed to do the design and development and a contractor to do the construction and installation. Other formal appointments may occur in operation and maintenance where suppliers for spare parts or service providers or contractors to maintain or fix or operate infrastructure may occur. But really the key ones here are the consultant and contractor roles. And if you find yourself in this space where you are able to be contracted directly by a public entity, I'm going to call you here the Blue Group, for instance, then looking at sort of legislation on how to contract with a public entity is really important. But what we don't see here is the multiple subcontracts, the multiple almost sub-private sector opportunities that come from this public sector opportunity. So the public sector opportunity is really that contract between the public entity and the consultant. But consultants need so many support systems from subcontractors and subconsultants who, for example, do field studies and scientific studies and scientific services, data collection. They need service providers from finance to cleaning to a range of other things. And they also need some information. And I think here is where the comment in the chat about certain technologies not being used by government or there's no opportunity from government to use certain technologies. There's a big opportunity to make your way into the public sector through consultants. Consultants have been hired by the public entity to find out which technologies are out there. And even though it might not benefit your business immediately to go and speak to consultants because they don't offer any formal contract, if you tell them about your technology and you can really convince a consultant that your technology is worth comparing in the options analysis and presenting to a public entity, that may result in more construction and installation projects downstream. So that's a very important sort of step in the ecosystem. And then if we look at contractors, again, contractors are appointed on a public sector level, but they require multiple subcontractors, suppliers, and service providers as well. And those are all really subcontracting, so it's private sector opportunity. But the origination of the project is coming from the public sector. That's why we are looking at the public sector in such detail. And then finally, operation and maintenance, whether it's in-house or contracted, at some level, there will be some procurement of contractors, suppliers, and service providers, or subcontractors, making it a private sector opportunity again. Now, looking at the Blue Group I mentioned earlier, where you're contracting directly with the public entity, it's really important to look at the procurement legislation. What are the rules with contracting with your public entity? So I've just listed a few here. I'm not going to explain all the complexities, but I will mention some key points. But please do refer to the industry brief as there's a lot more detail there. So the Public Finance Management Act, as well as the framework for supply chain management really sets out the rules of how each municipality or public entity can contract with you. There's a local government municipal finance management act and how they can manage their finances. So again, it involves the procurement, it links to procurement, and there are regulations linked to that. And then the preferential procurement policy framework, again, details of how to procure. There's a new procurement bill that's out for comment, and that's trying to consolidate a lot of this policy into one document. Hasn't been promulgated yet, but it is expected soon. But it's not expected to change the concept significantly. It's just trying to make it easier that it's not across multiple documents. And if we're looking at the water sector specifically, it's important to look at the Water Services Act and the Municipal Systems Act, as those are indicating the roles and responsibilities of each of these public entities and how they are meant to provide services. Now, a few key points from these policies and regulations. If you're bidding, so responding directly to a public entity tender, you would be required to register on the central supplier database and on the relevant municipality supplier database or public entity. It's important to know that there needs to be some sort of South African identification. So foreign businesses would need to partner with local businesses, and that's a large opportunity for small local businesses, as there's a lot of foreign businesses wanting to enter the South African market. They simply need a South African identification partner that can really help them grow. So that requires company registration and full name. There's also tax documents. I think that's straightforward. Declaring past work experience. And what I'd really like to highlight is complying with the preferential procurement regulations. So that's providing a triple BEE certificate. And again, that links to your South African registration. And an important one is if you're tendering on projects above the value of 30 million, that at least 30% needs to be subcontracted to a qualifying EME or QSE if they deem it as feasible to do so in this project type. And this provides real opportunity for small businesses to enter the market, and it highlights the need for businesses to partner with each other. And that's brings me to my next point, is really to find partnerships for those not contracting directly with a public sector, but rather finding the opportunities almost a little bit downstream, is this the subcontracting, the private sector value chain that is created by the public sector opportunity. So these are just a few general ideas of which partnerships to pursue. If you're a consultant, look for sub-consultants to partnership with, or bigger consultants if you are a sub-consultant, and look for service providers, look for specialist subcontractors. If you're a contractor, you might want to look at subcontractors or larger contractors, suppliers, service providers. And you could also work these in reverse. If you are a supplier, you need to be looking for contractors to partner with. You need to be looking for other service providers and other suppliers, as there may be a bigger supplier that you can partner with. And then again, service providers, looking for contractors, service providers, consultants, the whole range really there. This is very general and conceptual, but in our brief, we go into a bit more detail. So how do you find a consultant? Well, there's a database of all the registered consultants in each engineering industry, from civil to electrical to electronics, mechanical, and it tells you how big of a contract they are able to complete. So it's all detailed there for the consultants. It's the Consulting Engineering of South Africa, full database. Contractors, there's the CIDB, and the There's a number of other databases available as well. They're all listed in the industry. So have a look and see who is out there to partner with, and speak to them. And if you'd like some more detailed advice on who we can recommend to you to partner with, please do contact us, as this is one of our roles that we are here for, as Claire mentioned, funded by the Western Cape Department of Economic Development and Tourism. So we offer this free service to you to support you in partnering and developing your business.
Thank you. Thanks so much, Rudy. Yeah, I think a great reminder for everyone on the webinar that we don't just run webinars and write published reports, that we're here to assist you for free. So if you do have specific questions and you require additional insights, et cetera, you know, we really are available. So please get in contact with Rudy or Ashton and they can assist you. Thank you so much, Rudy. I've really found that interesting and always good to kind of see some of the creative and innovative ways to think about accessing this particular market. We've been a few additional questions that have come through in the chat. I think just a reminder to everyone, if you can put it in the Q&A, but it seems like the chat is the place to go now, but that's okay, whichever place you want to place it. I'm going to address some of those questions to Rudy now, noting that Ashton has responded to a few of them. But I think just again, we're going to launch a quick poll we'll close it off again towards the end of the Q&A. So this is really just in terms of thinking about your business, you know, what are the major barriers that you are experiencing in terms of actually entering the South African water sector market? We'd love this as an insight. So we obviously spend a lot of time talking to businesses, understanding, you know, what hurdles they're experiencing, but we'd love to hear from you as well to kind of help bolster our understanding of this particular space. So back to the questions. I think that Ashton has responded to the water loss through toilets for non-revenue water. As Ashton mentioned, typically that would, you know, be the kind of customer's responsibility. So yes, there's always non-revenue water that has also been legally supplied, right? So there will be, for example, indigent or poorer communities who possibly receive free water. So that would contribute, obviously, to the non-revenue water figure, but it wouldn't be seen as an illegal abstraction or unauthorized, right? It would be effectively an authorized non-revenue water volume. And yes, Lorelei, yeah, we're a non-profit organization. We don't take equity stakes in other entities, et cetera. And yes, the question around the low cost of water. I mean, I think this is often a barrier that we experience in South Africa. I don't know, Rudy, if you want to respond to that a little bit about some of the tariffs you've seen, et cetera.
Thanks, Claire. Yes, I think the tariffs across the country vary greatly. And I think what we often forget is that in a city, your water is coming from a lot further away, and that distribution network is often forgotten as a cost in getting water to each business and each user. We often see the bulk water tariff, and we see the residential water tariff. And in between those two, there's a significant amount of infrastructure that makes those two happen. And so it's very important where in a small town, your distribution and treatment is a lot easier and smaller and able to be more affordable. I think that's a large reason why we have the most expensive costs in metros. And it does mean that the opportunity for reuse is most significant in the metros. Because they are paying a higher water tariff, for an alternative to water, there are real opportunities in the metropolitans more so than in smaller towns. And it really makes sense just from a quantities perspective. The largest users of water overall in the country are going to be in the metropolitans. So trying to convert a small town to use an alternative water source is going to be potentially a drop in the ocean compared to converting a whole metropolitan.
Yeah, thanks, Rudy. And yeah, I mean, looking at that price of the water that was quoted there, I mean, that sounds like that may be a raw water abstraction. That doesn't sound like that's within a municipal or within a water service authority area. I mean, that's like agricultural rates from what I can see. In which case, it's really tricky. I mean, Rudy, can you tell me off the top of your head, like, kind of say, for example, what the City of Cape Town's industrial water tariff is? Am I putting you on the spot?
I think we had an average across metros of about R9 per kiloliter bulk charge for the metros over the last financial year. The few cents per kiloliter that's mentioned in the chat is really a bulk water supply. So it's a raw water abstraction from the river charge, and that goes to the Department of Water and Sanitation. So that bulk abstraction cost is their funding for a lot of the bulk water projects that we've seen. So for example, the Lesotho Highlands River project, that would be funded by those bulk extraction costs. And of course, the agricultural sector is abstracting in much larger volumes, and it's raw water, so untreated. And that's why the cost is so much lower.
Thanks, Rudy. And then, I think agreeing with Gerard as well around, with a tariff of that level, it's going to be very difficult to substantiate a reuse project. And yes, I think, even say, for example, during the drought that we experienced here recently within the Western Cape, sometimes businesses were investing in reuse schemes that didn't necessarily make the strongest business sense, but was more around security of supply. So it was an operational risk and it was kind of costed accordingly. So yeah, I think that's an accurate statement. I think in responding to Hans Selye's question around the water service intermediary licenses, to the best of our knowledge, the City of Cape Town hasn't placed a moratorium on these. Rudy, correct me if I'm wrong, but it seems that they're much more hesitant to issue new ones as they're looking to kind of bolster their revenue stream, post day zero, and they've got significant augmentation coming online and are not looking for some of their most important users to kind of effectively go off the grid. I don't know if Rudy, if you're able to respond to that a bit more coherently.
Thanks, Claire. I think there's another driver really from the City of Cape Town perspective, and that's the risk of providing WSI licenses when they can't guarantee that potable standards will be met. And so where we have industries that are installing their own reuse schemes, it can be a risk to any downstream users if that scheme fails. And so the city really needs to have guarantee that potable standards will be met from a safety perspective for any potable consumption downstream. And so that is, they're not certain really of how to enforce that and make sure that they can guarantee that. And that's a risk to them. And that's another contributing factor in addition to what you've already mentioned.
But I think to the best of my knowledge, there hasn't been a moratorium placed as far as I'm aware. Okay. But I mean, we can, of course, there we go. And Ashton's also responding to that. Okay, I think that's it. Thank you so much, Rudy. It was super interesting. Again, as you can see, guys, if you've got more questions, please post them in the chat or the Q&A, and Rudy can respond to them or get hold of her via email, and she'll happily jump on a call and respond there. We're going to, I think, end the poll now, Tula, and let's see from our audience here, what are the biggest barriers that they've been experiencing? Okay, procurement legislation. Yeah, I think this is definitely not a surprise, I guess, from our side, that has been a consistent concern that's been raised by the businesses that we work with. And I think from Green Cape side, we're consistently thinking about ways of trying to identify mechanisms to utilize within the existing procurement to still be able to access the public sector. And I mean, Rudy's example today, I think, is a clear example, is like, instead of directly tackling the government or the public sector, try find ways of working with the private sector that are already contracting with the public sector. So, but yes, I think it is certainly a challenge that is widely acknowledged. Okay, thank you so much. We're now heading off to our final presenter of this event. So I'm going to hand over to Adila Kasim. And Adila is going to be talking to us about the Green Outcomes Fund and around the kind of financing that is available for green SMMEs through this particular fund that has been supported and run by Green Cape. Again, if you have any questions about it, please raise them in the chat. Okay, thank you so much, Adila. Over to you.
Thank you, Claire, and good morning, everybody. My name is Adila Kasim, and I represent the Green Outcomes Fund at Green Cape. Now that my colleagues have presented the various opportunities in the municipal water sector market and gaining entry into the public sector market, I'd like to turn your attention to one of the most commonly faced challenges and barriers experienced, and that is in sourcing finance. So the Green Outcomes Fund is a Green Cape-led initiative mobilizing finance for the growth of green SMMEs. And it's an opportunity that is currently available for SMMEs in the water sector to access finance. And my presentation today will show you exactly how. But before diving right into the applications and signing on any dotted lines, I'd like to share with you how this initiative actually came about. So in South Africa, we realized that in order to foster a thriving green economy, new innovative finance models need to be developed to facilitate investments towards green SMMEs. So with this in mind, a consortium of partners collaborated to design a viable solution. And it consisted of a WWF South Africa, UCT's Bertha Center for Social Innovation at the Graduate School of Business, Green Cape, and the World Bank's Climate Technology Program. So together the parties designed the Green Outcomes Fund, which we call GOF, as a first of its kind structure, designed to grow the green impact investing market in South Africa by incentivizing and supporting local fund managers to invest in high impact green SMMEs operating with South Africa's green economy with greater efficiency and risk management in mind. So what GOF essentially does is that it provides outcomes-based match concessionary capital to both existing and emerging local investment funds, promoting investment in green SMMEs on the principle of payments for green outcomes generated, things like green job creation or climate change mitigation. So it acts as an incentive for local fund managers to effectively put money on the table towards green SMME investment through the benefits of using new approaches and financing models through the outcomes-based structure of GOF and offsetting the associated costs and perceived risks with green SMME investing. So due to the benefits of the structure, GOF is able to tap into these sources of private capital, unlocking and enabling access to more lending and investment solutions for green SMMEs. In order to effectively catalyze investment into the green economy, the GOF was designed in response to key bottlenecks identified within the sector and the challenges experienced by both green SMMEs and the South African fund managers. So when addressing green SMMEs, the predominant challenges experienced related to low levels of investor community interest, there being a lack of green business focused development support, and having very limited market access channels. This is where GOF steps in to address the challenges through offering to subsidize the investment in green SMMEs and in the process, unlocking opportunities for further financial and non-financial support to green SMMEs that would otherwise would not be feasible without GOF support. And on the other side of the spectrum, the main challenges experienced among South African fund managers when considering investment into the green economy relate to the high costs associated with green startups, the lack of investment grade quality pipeline, and their own limited green economy understanding and levels of expertise. So GOF steps in here to support these funds where intervention is needed the most to mobilize capital into green SMEs by offering green tech and advisory support, SME pipeline development assistance, and also grant-based subsidies. So what exactly has the Green Outcomes Fund mobilized? Since its launch in January 2020, GOF has raised grant funding and matched funding from both public and private sources to unlock 488.1 million rands in investment for local green SMEs. It's comprised of 92.6 million rands from the Jobs Fund unit at National Treasury and RMB's First Rand Foundation. And their grant funding contribution is coupled with 395.5 million rands in match funding from four different investment funds and finance partners to GOF, including Edge Growth, Business Partners, Conservation International Ventures, and Emergence Investment Managers. So in total, GOF has been able to mobilize a total of 488.1 million rands for investment in green SMEs as a first of its kind structure. Now that I've mentioned its structure, let's turn our attention to the structure of GOF and exactly how it works. So it starts off with our four fund managers who we call Catalytic Finance Partners or CFPs. To recap, it's Edge Growth, Business Partners, CI Ventures, and Mergence. The CFPs provide debt, equity, or mezzanine finance to green SMEs that they enter into an investment contract with. A green SME, once contracted with a CFP, must then create green direct permanent jobs throughout the duration of their investment, amongst other agreed upon targets. The SMME will then need to share the job verification details with the CFP, and in turn, the CFP will share that information with GreenCape to audit and verify under GOF, which is registered as a trust. GOF will then submit that verification to Jobs Fund, and once Jobs Fund approval is obtained, it triggers the grant capital disbursement for jobs that have been successfully created, which is dispersed from Jobs Fund to the CFPs via GOF is a grant outcome payment, which we'll talk about in a bit. So GOF is also committed to the development of knowledge around our structure and its implementation, hence the involvement of UCT's Bertha Center. We also have appropriate governance structures in place in the form of an advisory committee and an investment committee whom we report to. Now that I've mentioned the grant outcome payments, and if you're wondering, how does the grant funding from the funders dispersed via GOF to the CFPs benefit the SMEs? This is where the uses of the grant outcomes funding comes in. So the grant outcome payments are capital disbursements that are paid on a quarterly basis to the catalytic finance partners who invest in the green SMEs, who successfully generate verifiable green outcomes like permanent direct green jobs. So these outcome payments are targeted at reducing the risk and costs of supporting or investing in green SMEs. So in doing so, GOF has been able to identify the most prominent barriers in providing finance to green SMEs and allow for the use of these outcomes payments that you see in front of you to address the typical challenges. So therefore the grant funding, the outcomes funding, it unlocks additional support and services that a CFP can offer to an SME, which would not have been possible if the SME entered into any other conventional agreement with the CFP. So CFPs are guided by the five uses of outcomes payment instruments that you see on your screen. The first is business development support and technical assistance. So a CFP can make use of the funding to offer the green SMEs business development support, mentorship, or tailored technical assistance. So these services would be provided to ensure that your business risk is mitigated and your business performance is optimized, and it can be offered pre or post investment. The second is in-house technical expertise. So this allows a CFP to use the funding towards activities that are above and beyond what's normally required for a non-green investment, like, for instance, performing green due diligence or assessing the viability of a green business model and those associated costs. The third is on lending or investing, where CFP could increase its pool of capital available to green SMEs by adding the outcomes payments to this pool, which effectively drives more capital towards the green SME sector. The fourth is where a CFP can actually choose to subsidize the cost of capital. So a CFP may assess an investment to have the level of risk that requires a return greater than deemed sustainable by the green SME investee. But by using the GOF outcomes payments, the CFP can subsidize the difference in cost of capital. So as an example, if you as an SME are interested in taking out a loan, but you cannot afford anything above 8%, but the CFP considers you as an SME to be of the risk that requires a 10% interest rate, this is where the GOF outcomes payment comes in, because it can be used to subsidize that 2% difference, essentially de-risking the investment for the CFP and ensuring that you as an SME are able to afford that finance. And then lastly, innovative pricing models. A CFP can also provide an SME with an interest rate rebate. So in other words, being able to reduce the amount of interest due by the SME based on social or environmental milestones that can successfully be met with. And these are the ways in which that grant funding can be used by either one of the CFPs to unlock additional support or services to your SME, which would not be possible if you entered into any other conventional agreement with a fund. Now that we've covered what GOF is and how the structure works, here's an overview of the four CFPs and what they have to offer. Note that each one of these CFPs have different financial products on offer and deal sizes available within each of their funds. And this enables GOF to basically cover a wide spectrum of financing needs amongst green SMEs, operating within multiple sectors across energy, water, the circular economy, and sustainable agriculture as well. So as an SME, you can make an application with either one or more of the CFPs, as long as the application is within the thresholds of those financial products on offer and the deal sizes available. In order to apply, it's encouraged that an SME reads through and familiarizes themselves with the individual fund investment mandates, which are detailed documents that outline the specifics of each fund, which can be found on our website and which I will be directing you to very shortly. In order for a green SME to be eligible for GOF funding from either one of our CFPs, there are certain conditions that you will need to meet in order to make an application. First of all, you would need to be a locally registered SME. That means an SME as per the gazetted definition in the National Small Enterprise Act. Secondly, you need to be green. So green in the sense that your business know-how, procedures, goods or services, or organization practices are reflectively green in nature. Your green business should also limit any harm to the natural environment compared to conventional alternatives. And your business should operate within recognized sectors of the green economy. Third is you as a business will need to meet the investment criteria that is outlined by the CFPs in their fund investment mandates. And then lastly, your business must be capable of generating green permanent direct jobs, very important, that are either low, medium, or high skilled. And in addition to generating those jobs, the pilot phase of GOF tracks a suite of 13 recognized green metrics. So these green metrics fall under energy, water, waste, and sustainable agriculture, and it forms part of the rigorous system and approach for green outcome impact measurements as part of the monitoring and evaluation requirements for the pilot project. So an SMME will need to commit to measuring the applicable green metrics to their business on a quarterly basis and share this with our funds and fund managers to track your green impact. And now that we've covered the eligibility criteria for investment by the CFPs, this slide in front of you shows exactly where on our website green SMMEs will need to go to in order to apply. So on the link that you see in front of you, this is where you will find the fund mandate and application details for each CFP. It contains everything that you need to know in order to apply. And each of their application portals are also accessible via the website through a simple click of the buttons. And if you do require any support in completing an application, the fund mandates and application detail documents contain the contact details of representatives at each of the funds who will be on hand to guide you throughout the process. Now, if you find that the Green Outcomes Fund is perhaps not necessarily suited to your business and its current needs, there are other options available for you to consider. So GreenCap has a Green Business Support Services directory that lists a range of different support services available to green businesses. And these include the likes of research and development support services, ideation, incubation, acceleration programs, enterprise development support programs, and other forms of support. In addition, GreenCap also has a dedicated green finance database listing various funding opportunities available to all green economy stakeholders. So whether private, public, academia, or community-based. Our green finance webpage also hosts other funding resources like incentive booklets and crowdfunding sites, which we encourage you to visit as well. And that is the end of my presentation, so thank you very much. This presentation will be made available to attendees after the call through the Water team. And I'd be happy to take any questions from the floor if the time permits. Otherwise, I will address them in the chat. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Adila. Really, really amazing to see these opportunities that are being mobilized through the Green Outcomes Fund for SMMEs. I see that we've got two questions that have been posed in the chat as of now, and I'm going to put them to you both at the same time. So the first is really, what percentage of the 488 million that you mentioned up front has actually been invested in SMMEs? And then the second question was around the job creation requirement, right? So there's a problem that highly innovative technology requires highly specialized personnel, which means it's difficult to create jobs. I was wondering if you could maybe, in addressing this question, it's perhaps, if possible, and obviously let me know if this is confidential or not, but perhaps reflect on a couple of the successful applications and the kind of job creation outcomes that you've seen from them, if that's okay. Thanks, Adila.
Sure. So when it comes to the 488.1 million rands that we currently had, you've got the 395.5 million from the four catalytic finance partners. So that is the matched funding available in the form of debt, equity, or mezzanine finance for green SMMEs to apply to. In terms of how much of that is already available, quite a substantial amount. And that's simply because with the impact that COVID has had, we launched GOF during January 2020. And so there has been a bit of a time lag in getting those investments going. So our issue is not match funding. We have funding available. It is pipeline that we are looking to generate and hopefully get some SMEs to consider an application towards GOF. And the second question around job creation. So it's absolutely crucial that in applying for funding from either one of our fund managers, that an SMME can guarantee job creation through that investment. There are, of course, different job multipliers that are recognized against different industries. But what's most important is to be able to show that your business can create that impact and that you would be able to create jobs, whether they're low-skilled, high-skilled, medium-skilled, against what it is that you're actually asking of from the fund. So it is something that the fund calculates in relation to what the SMME actually applies for, and they will determine whether that is suited towards something that they're willing to enter into and supply or not. And an example, a few examples of what some of the current SMMEs under GOF are and some of the services that they offer. We currently have an SMME on board that provides a hardware device that not only is energy efficient, but it also tracks the health of your geysers. And so it can prevent any water loss through any potential bursting of pipes and geysers. We have SMMEs also in the waste and conservation agriculture sector, but we're struggling to find those SMMEs within the water and sanitation sector on board. And we're hoping that through these engagements that we'll be able to hopefully get some interest on the ground and hopefully have some water sector and sanitation sector SMMEs apply for GOF funding.
Thanks, Adila. Yeah, very interesting. I see, I think we've got one more question, which I think should be quite easy to answer. How is the lack of appetite for startup funding being addressed?
Well, very simply through initiatives like the Green Outcomes Fund in mobilizing finance out there and making it more attractive for investment managers to consider making that investment towards green SMMEs. When it comes to startups and the associated high risks, the grant payments through GOF acts as that incentive for different investment funds to actually consider making that investment towards green SMMEs and green startups.
And I think we've got our last question here. Would a laundromat that is looking to go green and create a further 5 to 10 jobs be able to qualify? So looking at better water practices, waste management practices, would they be able to apply?
Absolutely. So we spoke about eligibility criteria. So you would need to be green, not just in terms of your products, technologies, and services, but green in terms of your total governance. So your know-how, your business practices, your organizational practices, and things like that. So definitely yes, and especially yes, if you can guarantee the creation of permanent direct jobs in the green economy.
Thank you so much, Adila. And yeah, I think just to make notes, again, if you do want to get in contact with her for any further information or go to the website, there's a bunch of resources that are available there. So we've got 3 minutes left, I think, towards the end of the event, and we're bang on time, which is always great to see. So I think, again, just I'm going to ask Marielle to close off. But we've posted, some of the resources that are available in the chat. If you do want to get in contact with us, please do so through the email addresses, even if you just email water@greencape.co.za. And again, just thank you very much to the Western Cape Department of Economic and Development and Tourism for supporting this event. I'm now going to hand over to Marielle Result. Geez, I'm struggling with surname pronunciation this morning, to close us off with some final remarks. Just to say thank you very much for attending. Over to you, Marielle.
Thank you, Claire. Appreciate it. And yeah, I would, from my side, I would just like to thank all our speakers, our moderator, Claire Pengeli, Ashton, Rudy, and Adila. It's been very interesting. Sure, maybe just to highlight what you can look forward to in our 2022 market intelligence report. We've already highlighted two investment opportunities, which speak to the key investment opportunity highlighted today, which is water reuse. We will expand on that with bulk water infrastructure and the opportunities within the water value chain in our 2022 market intelligence report. And we're also looking at expanding on the smart city opportunity within the water sector. I would like to thank all of you for attending today. And again, all our speakers, it's been very insightful. Please reach out to Green Cape if you have any questions, if you have any ideas, any insights into where the market is going. We would love to hear from you and engage with you further. Enjoy the rest of your day. Thank you.